Well, this is the most restrictive place I've been in, but I'll try my best to convey what I want to. I was born in a family where art was more important than academics. My dad was a commercial artist, a photographer, and my mom was also into music. So the whole day you've been hearing to a lot of people who have been in visual arts, they've been in music, they've been in dramatics, they've been in, I think, also painting and some actors as well. So as a child, I would never be upset if I got just 75 in maths or 80 in science or 65 in something else. But if I didn't win the first prize in Kannada recitation, it would be hurting. So that was the upbringing I had as a child. So photography was my dad's profession. Since I was introduced to dramatics, I was introduced to music, I'm a classically trained musician, at least I used to be. I understand all of these artistic aspects of life, but I realize amongst all of these, photography is the most easiest form of art that anybody can embrace. For instance, if any one of you has to come here and sing for 2 minutes, how easy is it? It's going to be tough. If you have to paint a small painting, which is about 8 inches by 10 inches, it's going to take a long time to do that. Not just the time, even to master it. Forget acting, going on stage and doing, or acting as a dramatist is tough, but dance is probably even tough. So looking at how people are embracing photography today, I often wonder, why is this such a famous form of art today? How many of you take pictures? Not from your cell phone, but a camera where you claim to be a photographer. Anybody here? I can't see your hands, but I'm hoping there are a few. So great, there are quite a few people who are embracing photography as a hobby, as a form of art. Though I still find a lot of resistance in the world to treat photographs equivalent to paintings. Of course, they are not, because you can't reproduce paintings, but you can make 10 copies of photographs. Having said that, there's a lot of artistic know-how to have when you make a good photograph. So I'm here in this session to make a very, very honest confession. Today, I'm one of the reasonably well-known wildlife photographers of the country. I do travel to a lot of places. I teach a lot of people photography. And if you pinch me in the night and ask me what is aperture or ISO or shutter speed or composition, I'll sleep and answer the question. But what I truly believe is photography is not what I really live to do. What do I really like is the fact that I became a nature lover in my teenage years and early 20s. So by the time I was already in Accenture as a user experience designer about 15 years ago, I already was a passionate nature lover. So that means coming from a city like Mysore, I had no reason to stay in Bangalore on a weekend to run back to the Bandipurs, Nagarholes, BR Hills, and whatever other places that I could afford to go in my early 20s. am I supposed to see a, oh, that's okay, great. Fantastic. So I never imagined as a child that I would embrace photography as a profession. So like many of the young people of my generation, I ended up in the IT industry and I was already figuring out how to make websites, multimedia presentations, and what we call as user experience design. So my father being a photographer, I was always in the world of photography, where as a child, we would go on shoots, we would understand what photography is, even in the film era. But as I said, never ever occurred to me that I would want to do photography as a profession. But in my 20s, I realized my love for nature is growing and growing and growing, and I'm able to appreciate geography much better than I used to do in high school, because it was not about political boundaries of a country, but about natural history of this world. What is Patagonia? What is the Andes? What is the Himalayas? And all these kind of lovely places. And along with that, what kind of life exists? What kind of birds live? What kind of animals live? And I started getting deeply interested in nature and wildlife. I strive hard today to get as close as possible, sometimes too close. But the answer to the question I ask myself about why did I become a photographer is not because of why many people think. I don't really love photography as much as I love nature and wildlife. So why do I do photography then? I realized very early in my, during my IT days when I used to do photography very seriously, I won a few awards, I was published in a lot of magazines. I realized very early that the kind of photography I was interested in with wildlife and nature would never be a profession where I would take pictures simply every day and get paid for it. For a photographer, who pays? The subject pays. You take a picture of a beautiful wedding, and probably the bride's parents or the groom's parents pay for you, or sometimes even the brides and the grooms. But here, my tigers were never going to pay me, my polar bears were never going to pay me. So who's going to pay me to lead a life? So even now, one of the volunteers asked me, is photography your profession, or is that just something you do for a passion, right? So it was very tough to envision a career out of photography. So I'm going to spend the next 5-6 minutes sharing some ideas on why photography is not my destination. It is the route to my destination. Wonderful. I'm a little confused. Which is the slide currently? The left one is the current one. Great. Fantastic. Okay. So I call myself a natural history photographer, which means I take pictures of anything that lives, anything that is not man-made. For example, or anything that is not domesticated. A lovely wild dog in your house, which is, let's say, a German Shepherd, is not a subject for me because it is domesticated. You feed it, you take care of it, you take it to the spa these days too. So that's not a subject I am after. But I am after beings like birds and mammals and frogs and amphibians and snakes and even landscapes and wilderness areas that make my life exciting. So before I tell you what I have been through in my life so far, I'd like to show you a few beautiful things that I have witnessed. How many of you like wildlife here? Fantastic, that's more hands than photography, that's what I love. Great, so when you go to the wilderness, when you go to the wild, when you see an animal like a tiger being itself, the satisfaction you get, the thrill you get, the pleasure you get is second to none. So let me come up with a philosophy I make up for this particular thing. As a photographer, some of you raised your hands that you were photographers, right? Who do you take pictures for? Yourself or for an audience? I don't mind you guys answering loud right now. Anybody? Whom do you take pictures for? Yourself or for an audience? Audience? Fantastic. Many people say, I love to take pictures for myself. I do photography for myself. I was very clear very early in my endeavor with photography and my career with photography. Photography is not for myself. If it is for myself, I would like to enjoy that without my camera. When I look at something like, let's say, a tiger with its cubs playing on the lovely sunshine under the tree or on the rock, you know, I would love to see that myself. But here, I chose a profession where I would sacrifice my personal pleasures to take some pictures, to bring it back, edit it on my computer, upload it on, let's say, Facebook or Instagram or wherever, or put it up in my exhibition gallery and show it to people. Most of what I was doing was for others. So I look at photography as some kind of a little sacrifice I'm doing from enjoying nature, which is actually what I really want to do, and that is the motto of my life. To see a lot of this planet, to see a lot of wildlife of this planet, to travel to every nook and corner of this planet, right? So I'm sure some of you have seen tigers, have you? One of the most beautiful moments of your life would be when you first saw a tiger in the wild. Not in Mysore Zoo, but let's say in a place like Bandipur, or let's say Bandhavgarh or Ranthambore or Tadoba or many other places these days. When I was in my 20s, we could hardly see tigers because they were not so used to people. Tigers also live in places which were ancient relics. For example, this is a tiger from a national park called Ranthambore in Rajasthan. Rich cultural heritage in the state. A lot of forts which were abandoned in the national parks. Now this tiger is the king of this jungle and the palace too. Africa happens to be one of my most cherished lands, and I love Africa so much that till the day I die, I would like to keep going to Africa every year at least once. So if anybody has been to Africa, I don't need to explain why. It's one of the best places in the planet if you are a nature lover. Do you agree? Now, looking at, I'm really not very happy with the presentation because there's a lot of light on the photos. It should actually be viewed at a little darkness, but that's okay. My photos are better than that, I promise. So, witnessing a cheetah chase and hunt an impala like this is something which most of us have done, right? But on Nat Geo or Discovery, it's getting better, thank you. On Nat Geo or Discovery or something like that. But imagine looking at something like this in nature, which is really second to none. One of the most interesting sights is a hunt. Or let's say after the hunt, the king of the jungle, or let's say the lion, is feasting on the meal, and this is not lipstick, but it's bloodshed, face or blood with the animal's blood on the face of the lion, for example. Or let's say somebody as close as you with respect to the DNA, but as different as it can be with looks. let's say, a Central African forest of Congos and how you see gorillas. 900 of them alive, and if you've seen one of them, you've seen a big percentage of them. Or let's say you travel to a place in the far east of this world, let's say Japan, and the northernmost island of Japan, a place called Hokkaido. Many people don't even know about this place. I must say a few people know about this place. Hokkaido is the northernmost island of Japan. It's the dragon's head. And in the winter, there's a great place with lovely light and a lot of, cranes come here, and it's one of the most beautiful places for wildlife photography. Or if you go further north from Japan, you reach Russia's far east called Kamchatka. I don't know how many of you have even heard of this place, one of my favorite destinations to travel to. Kamchatka is actually a far eastern Russian state where people were not allowed to travel until the 90s because it was a military conflict zone. But this is one of the best places in the planet to see brown bear fishing salmon. I'm sure you've heard of Alaska, which is the more glamorized brown bear country, but Kamchatka is almost the same without a lot many tourists. Or in the tropics, there is an island called the Borneo, which I love to go to. Borneo is one of the oldest rainforests and probably the third biggest island in the world after, of course, Greenland and Antarctica. And this is one of the beautiful places where you can see a lot of rainforest beings. This animal is called a rhinoceros hornbill, the bird on the left. And on the right, if you have read Tintin, you would have seen this guy, the proboscis monkey. So my life revolves around going after all of these exotic species and even to places like Antarctica. So this is a chinstrap penguin. Right now the pair is actually courting. They're preparing for a season of breeding. And once they court and they mate and the female is ready to lay eggs, then they take turns to actually go and feed while the other is always taking care of the eggs, incubating it, not letting it open so that the predators come and eat them. So they're always taking care of these precious offsprings of theirs. So this is a chinstrap penguin. So Antarctica is a very beautiful place. In fact, a lot of wildlife in Antarctica exists in the sub-Antarctic region rather than the mainland. There are huge penguins like the emperors which live on the mainland as well, but a lot of wildlife on the fringes of the continent. Anybody been there? If you're lucky? Great. Costa Rica is one of the places which I really, really enjoy, because if you're a bird lover, the kind of birds you see here, the kind of animals you see here, the frogs you see here is not present anywhere else. It seems it is 0.003% of the landmass of the planet, but has about 4 to 5% of the species of the world. Can you imagine that? So many species of insects, birds, reptiles, and of course some mammals like jaguars too. And hummingbirds, of course, is probably the best opportunities you can have in Costa Rica. Coming down south in South America, I love this place called the Pantanal, which is in Brazil, where I travel every year in order to photograph the jaguars. Jaguars are very similar to leopards, but they don't climb trees like leopards in Kabini or in some other places in India. But jaguars hunt around the rivers. And do you know what's the most primary or prime diet of the jaguar? It's the crocodile called the caiman, one of the subspecies of the crocodile called the caiman. So it's a fantastic place to be there as well. Of course, the hero of Pantanal is the anaconda. And if you come across one, not the ones like you've seen in the movies, which is completely, it's made to look like that, but they're very docile, very nice little snakes, sometimes 14 feet long, but beautiful to handle them. I love the landscapes too. I go to US in the central area of America, in the great west of America, where you see the Grand Canyon, the Bryce Canyon. This is a picture of the Bryce Canyon National Park also. And there are beautiful areas where you have wildlife in America, but not as easy to see them like in Africa. And of course, Iceland today in the travel map is one of the most brightest stars. The people from India are running after the northern lights. Sometimes they go even in the summer saying, I want to see northern lights. But Iceland is also interesting. One of the most interesting places for me is this place called Svalbard, which is a place I go to photograph the polar bears. Polar bears are close to my heart. They are the species which I really love to see every day, and I love to go to this area to take pictures. Now, as a wildlife photographer, I had to evolve my skills, and I keep hearing this term in management called a blue ocean strategy. Quite literally, I don't know how many of you know what is blue ocean strategy. It's getting out of the crowded reef and figuring out something on yourself, which is very true to all of you today. When you're in a cluttered environment, you have to find different skills to survive in the industry. underwater photography is also a great passion. I think when I go underwater, I can literally hear my heartbeat, and I enjoy whatever I see there, which is a special thing to do. Sometimes animals are very close to your cameras, and that's one of the most rewarding moments when you're underwater for 30, 40 minutes and you see some spectacular things. As a career in photography, I've been telling you all the great places that I visit and all the wildlife that I have been seeing, but photography was not the reason for me to go there. In fact, the reason to go there was the passion for all these places, the animals, the wildlife and everything, but I probably started using photography as just a road to reach to my destinations, not just due to photography I went to places. So, as a photographer, I also had to evolve my skills and become a little more creative and abstract, because everybody can take a sharp picture of a tiger today, which was not possible 10 years ago, but it's possible to take a sharp picture of a lion or a tiger today. So you had to evolve your skills as a photographer as well. Now, I specialize in making creative wildlife photographs, which is not just a what you see is what you get kind of a picture, but to make use of the science of your camera to produce a piece of art that you can't see through your naked eye when you see the animal. So that's what I specialize in. Sometimes slow shutter speeds are what I embrace, sometimes very wacky ideas. Like, for example, this is a zoom burst image, which is used to capture photographs of birds in flight, or sometimes use equipment like the fisheye lens to capture a horizon which looks like I'm shooting this from, let's say, the satellite. Or simply use light very dramatically by exposing something which is not the way you see through the naked eye, which is what I think photography is. It's not a photocopy machine where you input a scene, press a button, get an output. You have to process it in your mind, click a picture by closing your eyes. So after all of these kind of creative pictures, I have traveled to a few places. I have a minute and a half, so I'll make it quick. So I have traveled to a few places where, you know, this is the kind of workstations that I have today. But if you look at the goal I have set for myself, I have only achieved about 15-20% of what I want to. The world is gigantic. The number of places that I want to visit are quite a lot. But I come back to the reason of why I'm a photographer every day, because I want to travel and experience nature and look at all the wildlife around. So before close my talk, I want to tell you that today it's a business. We've been taking hundreds and thousands of people across the globe to all of these beautiful places. My company is called Toehold. And here, the USP of the business is to put my client in front of me and make sure he gets a picture that he deserves too, because he's also a nature lover. Now, I'd like to tell you, after all of this, this is the reason why I do photography and not the camera or the gadgets or anything, right? So a small thought before I leave. It's a little bit of a Sanskrit. I'm sure you must have heard of this language 5,000 years ago, right? So what it actually means is, I'm sure you can read, what it actually means is you are a great talented animal, like let's say a lion, but if you just sleep and open your mouth, the prey won't enter in, right? So you have to make an effort to hunt and make your own kill. So I'm sure all of you have great talent. It's just a matter of how you use it. Thank you very much.